introduce myself. My name is Oh.
Welcome, everybody. Tell everybody you've got to buy a copy of this book. It's going to change lives. The principles that Matt speaks about are really quite something. If you would just indulge me, just a few thank yous. Thank you to the editors, Nadine and Claire. Thank you to Trisha, the typesetter. Thank you to Matt's incredible team at Digital Kung Fu. Thank you to Mups for being our In Conversation partner.
Reach.
And thank you to Exclusive Books for hosting the launch, and to Marlies, who's the branch manager, and her team. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
So this evening, Mups and Matt are going to have a conversation about some of the topics that are covered in the book. And after they've spoken, the floor will be open for a few questions. Please do buy a copy of the book, more than one. Pass it on to friends, family, colleagues, and Matt will sign the copy of your book for you. Mups is, I don't really need to introduce him, he's one of South Africa's favorite personalities. He is a style icon, a designer, a businessman, an actor, a TV presenter. What more can I say? South Africa's good guy. And then my last thanks is to Matt. Matt, thank you. It's been my privilege to be your publisher. And I really do believe your book's going to change people's perspectives. And once someone's read this book, they're going to know there's absolutely no excuse to not do whatever they want. Over to Matt and Mups.
Thanks, Tracy.
Thank you very much. And congratulations to Tracy on yet another book. I think a big round of applause for her. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us this Thursday evening. I know that we're easing into what is a pseudo-Friday today, as we get to enjoy a bit of a long weekend. For all the women in the crowd, happy Women's Day for tomorrow. It's all about you tomorrow and all about you all month, and should be all about you every day. yes, pretty much. Thank you for joining us. This is something I really love talking about. It's actually great to be on this side of the conversation with Matt, because Matt and his team, his team is awesome. Well, really, they're collectively called Matt and the Brownies. he has this great podcast. I'm sure each and every one of you have listened to over 1 million downloads and even more streams across the world, across 100 countries, which is absolutely incredible. And it's conversations about entrepreneurship, conversations about your life journeys to success, failure. But I always love in those conversations how it really highlights the failures and how important that is, which is something that we'll get into a little bit later. And it's something that I feel has helped a lot of the conversations you've had, those people become the successes they have, is by embracing that. This will be a great success, this book. I will have to also put it upon me to help promote it as much as possible, because I think people do need to go out and read this book. And this is a really, really big thing. So congratulations to you. And I think for putting yourself on the block like that and writing a book, first and foremost, you just turned 40. I don't even
so
look
at it. So published before 40. So.
Hashtag published before 40. Hashtag blessed. you are a father, and now you are an author, you're a businessman, but why the decision to go about and do that now?
Peer pressure. Basically, peer pressure. I'd been approached numerous times by Tracy to write a book. Many of my peer group had said, write a book, write a book, write a book, write a book, and eventually I just took the plunge and said, screw it, I'm going to do this thing. And then penned the deal with Tracy, and then 9 months later she phoned me and said, where's the book? And I was like, I haven't started yet. but because, you know, writing a book is a difficult thing, and, you know, imposter syndrome is a very real thing. People think that, you know, success happens overnight, and there was no failure, and there was no inner doubt whatsoever or no fear of failure. So writing a book, it's very different to, you know, creating a video for LinkedIn or for social media, because if you've got, you know, 10,000 people on LinkedIn and like 100 see that today, that's it, it's gone. No one will ever see that again. But with a book, it's always there and you're kind of trapped in what you write. And the kind of tension that I still have even sitting here today is that, you know, people change. Like each and every one of you here today are on a personal transformation journey. Some, you know, care to admit that and some don't. But deep down, everybody knows. And we're always trying to work out like who we are and what are our unique gifts and what action should I take and who should I take these kind of, you know, actions with. You know, you change. And so I was talking earlier this week on a show about, you know, when I'm 50 and I read the book, will I still buy into the words? Will it still be me? And that was a really big thing, you know, was trying to find your voice and trying to find what makes you unique and what makes your story different, and then trying to articulate that in a way that people will find memorable, relatable, and understandable.
And it certainly is draws a lot of nostalgia, which helps, I think, take people to certain periods of time in the country and try and draw back on their own stories and sort of then try think of what you were thinking while you're letting us into your thoughts and try and track your journey along the way. I love the whole example of your dad being an entrepreneur himself. And I think the company is called Cape Gun. Was it Cape
Handgun, yeah.
Cape Handgun. And how that seemed like such a great success until it became an absolute failure in the end, because it just, you know, it didn't go to plan. And it's something that you thought would always continue to be a success. But unfortunately, what it looked like from the outside was not what was happening on the inside. And timing was everything.
Yeah, timing was everything. It was a difficult time for our country. So Chris Hani got shot. And my dad just happened to have the foresight to have a private gun shop. So anyone from the public could go and, you know, buy guns over the counter like you would buy literally a book. And, you know, when Chris Hani got shot, we were literally on the brink of civil war. And I was about sort of 12 years old. And they printed money. They sold more guns than, you know, it was just cash, cash, cash every single day. And they did very well out of it. But the business eventually failed. And, you know, that was the spark of curiosity really for me. It was kind of like saying, well, why didn't it get bigger? Do you know what I mean? Like if you achieve some form of success, why does it stop? Why do things kind of taper off? And then, as we all know, like 98% of small businesses fail. But why is that? And so that was really the curiosity and the spark of my journey in terms of entrepreneurship. The answer very simply was it comes down to, funnily enough, your inner game. Like their model of business didn't lend itself to scale, number one. And number two, they weren't hungry for scale. You know, the difference between a guy who builds a really big fucking business and one who builds a kind of small mom and pop shop, and that's fine. I'm not saying that one's better than the other. But if you do have the ambition to build a really big business, there's only one word that you need to remember, and that's hunger. You know, you got to be hungry for risk. You got to be hungry for walking that wire every single day. And being curious about what's in it for you first, and then what's in it for you and the people that work with you to support the vision of that business. And that's a very important lesson. You know, and the other thing I want to say, just, you know, I've interviewed hundreds of successful billionaires in four continents, and the thing that really jumps for me is not one of them view themselves as successful. You know, like, you know, I could call you successful, but I know deep down that you don't view yourself as successful. Because, you know, success equals mediocrity. You know, what is success? What does it actually mean? You know, how will you know when you get there? And is it enough? You know, and those are the questions that... How much is enough? Is it $1 billion? Is it 100 million? Like, what really matters to you? And the thing with entrepreneurs, especially startup founders, is that they kind of get romanced about the Silicon Valley narrative. You know, it's like, you know, I'm going to start a business and 6 months later, I'm going to, you know, sell that business for $100 million. I'm going to move to the south of France in my super yachts, and I'm going to do Bolivian cocaine with a bunch of Russian supermodels. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's this dream. And, you know, and the media paints this picture, and it's not true. Because for every one of those media clippings where it's like, you know, Lyft raises $30 million in seed round, I mean, it's crazy money. You know, for every one of those headlines, there's hundreds of thousands of crushed dreams. And those are the people that I care about. You know, I don't care about the guys who are successful. By the way, even if they did raise that money, I can promise you they don't actually fully accept the realities of what that means, because suddenly you're an employee again. Yeah. Now you've got investors that want 20 times their money back, but you didn't sign up for that. You just wanted the dream.
Which happens to end up being a failure for, well, the problem for a lot of entrepreneurs, and they end up losing out on their own dream because they end up working for someone else at the end of the day. Just a little disclaimer, the book is very PG, although our conversation is 16 SNL in those little moments, just so you know. this is where it gets brutally honest and
authentic.
Very authentic and graphic. Speaking of authentic and graphic, just a bit of a light note. Today is like a bit like your wedding day for some of your family members. I heard your wife Nina, who you shout out at the start of the book, actually wanted you to wear white, which possibly would have gone with that whole Peruvian drug dealer whole.
It would have.
Hindsight's
perfect science.
But honestly, in the book, what I particularly love is you're able to kind of group mantras, essentially, with each chapter for people to be able to walk away with. So I will find my purpose. I will not live with regrets. I will not be fearless, but I will fear less, and many others. But I'd love to just dissect a few of those, particularly starting off with remembering your why and finding your purpose.
So I don't know if how many of you have heard of a guy called Joey Evans before? Okay, so
I heard about him in your book.
Yeah, it's actually in my book. You should check it out. So Joey Evans, his passion was motocross riding, and his why was, you know, I want to compete in the world's longest and toughest endurance race, the Dakar. And unfortunately, life has a way of throwing you curveballs. And he was in a motorbike race, and essentially, very long story short, or long story long, but basically he was crippled from the neck down. He was told he would never walk again. He's got four daughters, all right, and a wife. So imagine that. And slowly but surely over time, he overcame his injury. And even when he started to go through the incredible pain of rebuilding his body and his motor neuron system, he was in another accident and literally got taken out, put in hospital for 6 months. And he got back again after that horrific accident and eventually raised 1.5 million rand to enter the Dakar. Only 7 South Africans have ever finished the Dakar. And he finished it. And even in the race, this is crazy, crazy stories. There's no way he should have made it. There was no way. And it's those kind of stories that help me, or really helped me, to understand the power of human potential that lies within everybody. And we need to acknowledge the fact through these stories that this potential lies in all of us. The only difference is that you need to fully decide that this is the thing that I will do, regardless of what stands in my way. And it's very easy to say the words, but when you live your own kind of self-worth and your own expectations of yourself and your own fears and your own inner doubt through the stories of others, that is when you start to relate. That's when you start to, you know, rewire your brain and make new connections in terms of your own unique possibilities. And that's what I fundamentally believe. I mean, when I started podcasting 4 years ago, I was a complete fraud. Like, I had zero confidence. I'd failed too many times to care to really write about. I kind of allude to a few of them in the book. But I lacked what I needed to become successful. And I cannot put into words the transformational journey that just having ordinary conversations has had in my own life. And the book is really a chronology, a lexicon of the most powerful stories that I've encountered over 4 years of researching and really building a global media platform that is there to exist for one reason only, and that is to help entrepreneurs and business leaders around the world succeed through information sharing at scale. That was always the why. If I didn't have that why, I should have stopped podcasting after 2 weeks. I nearly did.
Yeah.
But thank God I didn't, because it wouldn't be where we are today.
Well, even on that, in fact, I'll get back to that right now. Just on remembering your why. I'm very lucky enough to know what my why is. You may be lucky enough to know what your why is. Joey Evans was lucky enough to know what their why is. But a lot of people don't really know what their why is. So when it comes to that moment of wanting to quit whatever it is they're doing and trying to remember what their why is, how do you actually help them tap into what that even was? Because you can lose sight of that too.
Yeah, it's a difficult thing. I don't think you ever find it. You're not going to find the perfect relationship. You're not going to find the perfect job. You're not going to find the perfect business. You're not going to find your purpose. You have to create things. You have to be at cause, not at effect. So when you decide that I'm going to create this purpose for my life, you need to execute on that and figure out whether that is, in fact, something that you want. The difference is that people, oftentimes, they don't even try. So an interesting way to get perspective, like real perspective, not an opinion, and in a perspective that's your own, is to think about your death. So the day that you die, right? So imagine for a moment, just stop and imagine for a moment that it's the day of your funeral, okay? Your best friend or one of your family members is talking about you. What are they saying? Imagine the actual words. Hear the words. What are they actually saying about you? Who did you become? Who did you help? What contribution to the world and society did you make? You know, those are the questions that truly matter. And so thinking about your death, and it was an interview I did with Robin Wheeler, another author who's written like way more books than I ever will. But he wrote this book called Death is the Ultimate Orgasm. And we were talking about the power of death, you know, and thinking, because I think when you're born, your death is immediately intertwined in that event. We will all die. That is the only certainty. And so when you understand that and you work backwards to where you are today and the time that you have left, what are you going to do about it? What words can you imagine? What words would you like people to describe about you, right? And is that enough? You know, are they going to say that you became super wealthy and you sold a business for $100 million? Or are they going to care that you started the Dreamers Dojo and it was an initiative that was there to interrupt the kind of screwed up school system that exists today and to make kids and the youth future fit for an exponentially driven world? Like, what are they going to say about you? And it takes reflection. You know, people, you know, we don't remember the experiences. We remember how we felt. And when you reflect on things, that's when you remember things. You know, and so reflection is one of the, it's free, by the way. And when you reflect on your life and you reflect on the people that are in your life, where and what are you going to do with it? What is your story? What bullshit are you telling yourself about why you can't have the things in your life? You know, and I was that person. And it was only through individual conversations just like this, the power of an ordinary conversation, and that has the power to transform ordinary people and to do what helped them to unlock the capabilities to do extraordinary things.
Yeah, and personally, I know I've never, to a certain extent, felt good enough in a lot of the things that I do. It deepened my imposter syndrome not featuring in the book at all, but we'll get to that a little bit later.
You're in the next one. So you're out again.
Out again. But in terms of that purpose, quite literally for you, those reminders that you have around you for remembering your direction, your true north, you know, kind of mapping things out for you, what are those things that keep you moving towards, you know, what that next thing always is for you so that you know that you're moving forward? And I use those kind of different analogies, so to speak, because of the tattoo on your left forearm of the compass.
Yeah, I've got tattoos all over me. but that's a discussion for another day. But basically, you know, it is about understanding what your true north is, you know, and I use the analogy of, you know, if you're building a business, it's like going to sea, right? And I'll use the actual story. So there was a guy, a military general, put all of his ships on boats, invaded a foreign land. And when they got to the foreign land, he told all his lieutenants to burn all the ships. Why would he do that? Because there's only one way. You have to go forward. And that is the difference. You know, it's like if you remember what your true north is, your why, and why you exist as an individual first, and your role in the lives of others, the immediate role in the lives of others. That's when magic happens. That's when Joey Evans can decide he's going to walk again when six doctors tell him he will never walk again. Where does that come from? Where does that belief in one's capability come from? And this is documented in like countless stories. This is very, very real. It's not an opinion. This is the truth. And the book is really... you know, my probably one of the biggest outcomes is just to get people to understand that there's more within you. Yeah.
Your inner game code, Is that something that you came up with yourself?
There, no, that was my wife.
You should really cite your sources in your book.
She is mentioned, you know.
Why did that strike such a chord with you to identify it as that?
I think there's a lot of business books out there that write about strategy and disruption and innovation and tech adjacent and it's all external, you know. In the 9 months that I was waiting to write a single word, that was the question that I had in my mind, which was, what am I going to write about? What's going to make the biggest difference? And, you know, on the podcast, it was purely through the experiences that I had interviewing people such as yourself, et cetera. And we spoke about legacy, for instance. It's everything in business is personal. It's weird. It's like one of the biggest lessons, like if I were to draw a pie sort of graph and say, well, you know, of the 100%, how much of business is kind of business and personal? I'd say it's 80% personal, 20% business. Because a business can only grow to the extent that you do. That is the absolute fact. And, you know, your world can't change unless you grow. It has to come from inside of you. That book, you know, my sister, I spoke to her yesterday. I said, what do you think about the book, Massive Imposter Syndrome? And she just said, it's totally you.
Yeah. I'm assuming that's a good thing.
I would hope so. It's too late now.
How difficult or how much easier did you find that it was to be able to write this book, being able to draw from all your interviews coupled with your experiences as opposed to just your experiences? Or is it just more of what you emphasize in the book of making sure that you put yourself out there to experience as much as possible and use those learnings that you experience and other people's mistakes and experiences to create your own success in the end?
Yeah, I mean, the book's actually less about me. I mean, I kind of wrote it, but it's actually about ordinary humans doing extraordinary things. And so that's actually what made the book easier to write. You know, obviously it has to come from you. There's a lot of me in there. But really it's about, you know, life's too short to make your own mistakes, you know. And if you really want to learn how to shortcut and hack growth as an individual first and then financially and economically and whatever that means to you and whatever success means to you, it's about other people, you know, and discovering what other people have learned so that you don't have to have motorbike accidents and be told you're never going to be walk again in order to learn the thing about belief. Does it make sense? Or about the value of legacy, you know, and whatever that is. But it's about other people first. I don't know what it is, but it's like when you put the world before yourself, that's when you really start to find that things unlock for you.
And speaking of putting the world before yourself and things unlocking for you, in your section of not living without regrets or with regrets, there is a certain doctor that you speak to, physicist, innovator, Dr. Adriana, and she's one of the ladies who will be journeying into Mars and will actually be leaving her entire life behind her family, and has chosen that this, you know, she's known that this is what she's wanted to do her whole life, live on another planet and die on another planet and explore another planet. And for me, I can't even fathom that. I think about my death all the time. I'm seeing someone about that. But I can't...
We should talk.
I can't possibly fathom that massive decision of just being like, yeah, I'm leaving everyone here. She's in her, I think, early 30s or something, or late 30s.
Yeah, she's young.
She's quite young. She's in her early 30s. And not to say more than that is not young. But she's decided that she's leaving everything behind and she's going to go and die there and leave her whole life here. But for her, it's the most incredible thing, and she's so excited. How are you able to relay someone's story like that when it's even hard to just fathom that as just in conversation?
Yeah, I don't understand some people. I don't. But that's fine for them. You know what I mean? But also the other thing is, you know, it's also about accepting that things are the way that they are for you. Like for her, she's accepted her truth, which is, hey, I'm going to Mars, and like, hey, cheers, mom, cheers, dad, cheers, brother, like, cheers, all my friends. I will never see you again. I'm going to Mars, and I'm going to die there. Imagine that. Imagine making that decision, and then your mom, honey, listen, you know, are you really sure? Are you 100% sure? No, I'm definitely, I'm gone. I'm like, I'm there. You know what I mean? Like, I'm done. What about, like, but what about kids? Like, no, puppies, dog, no, I'm going to Mars. I'm going to go die on Mars. Because that's the thing, right? Because, but the thing is, right, it's like, I believe that the only reason why she's able to have such conviction is that she accepts her story for it being what it is. You know, and I spoke, you know, we're doing this whole series on my show at the moment called Women of Steel. And people aren't, they're too scared to really address the psychodrama that they have in their lives. Do you know what I mean? Why? It's like you either get someone who's prepared to address the truth about like horrific things that happened to you, because we all have pain sitting here today, everyone. No one's an angel. And, you know, if you really want to find out what makes you different, you have to go inside yourself and figure out that psychodrama shit. You have to address that shit, you know. And when you do, you find the story. You know, and that's culminated in this book. But for Adriana going to Mars, that is her thing. You know, that is what lights her up and what makes her different.
I mean, I definitely think it's admirable. I just try to think of that impact that you have on, your family and the people around you. And that it's essentially like a suicide. And you, this person's gone. You'll never see them again. But they are alive. And I think being able to relay that story is really powerful in terms of living your life without regrets and actually just going after whatever it is that you want to go after.
Yeah, because you're not going to regret the things you did.
Yeah.
Like, I don't regret the 6 business failures. You know, I don't regret the late nights and, you know, the sacrifices that I've had to make. But I can tell you what I do regret is the things that
Nina's looking at you like she does.
She knows. But, you know, you're only going to regret the things that you didn't do. You know, that's the truth. It's Rich Mulholland said a great story about her grandmother, or his grandmother, was basically dying on her deathbed, and she was crying. And he said to her, "Why are you crying?" And she said, "When I was 20 years old, it was in the war, something like that."
I feel so bad that you would speak, because this is another great story in the book that, you know, you don't want to give it away.
Okay, I'm going to stop there.
Yeah, I think you should stop that. I'm really sorry.
The book's up, yeah.
But there are a lot of those beautiful stories in the book. I think that is one of them, just you want to keep personally.
That's a great cliffhanger. Well done.
To yourself. Do you want to just repeat it and then just stop there?
No, no, it's fine. You got the message.
Now, tell me about the fact that, that section of I will not be fearless, I will be fear-less. As opposed to I will not be fearless, I will fear less.
It's a complicated question. But I guess the truth of that one is, you know, we all live with fear. Like, you know, when I was 26 and I had my first business failure, I'd sold my record label previous to that, and I decided it would be a really good idea to teach people about life. Kind of like weird. I feel like I've gone full circle over the last 14 years. And the only thing about a 26-year-old is that no one wants to take advice from a 26-year-old about life. And so that business completely tanked. And when it did, it was my first real business failure, where it was financial, it was motivational, it was self-worth, it was a complete dog show. And it took me a long time to pick myself up and actually say, you know what, I'm worth it, I'm going to take another shot. And so it's fear, right? What if I fail again? I mean, geez, there's so much stuff I could tell you personally about where we were at as a family. Like, it had to work. If it didn't work, I mean, I just had my first baby. It was a very, very touch-and-go situation. And I remembered that time, and I remembered about the reason why I failed all those 6 times. And the simple reason was I decided to quit. The fear was too much, and I quit. It was just too much for me. I didn't have it in me. I didn't have it in me then. But over time, I learned to accept that that was my truth. That failure is a necessity. It's not an option. You have to fail to be successful. And today, you know, if I haven't failed today and every day, I don't have a good day. I encourage my team here to fail every single day, because when they fail, they get better. You know, and the other thing I learned about failure is that when a business fails, like my best mate friend in here, you know, God forbid he has to have a business failure. But the lesson that I'd want him to know is that if that ever happens and a business fails, it's not you that failed. The business failed. But I didn't realize that. And it took a conversation with Alon Reyes, CEO of Reyes Corp, to learn that. That failure is not personal. right? It's just a necessity. And when you can distance yourself from that, you can start to unlock this idea of not living without fear, but instead embracing fear and being fearless. I'm able to make decisions despite of my fear. I'm able to make 4 job offers in a single week just because I can, you know, and being able to operate at a higher performance level despite what I'm feeling inside, which is fucking complete petrification, you know what I mean? Like, just really, really scared. But it's okay because that's normal, you know. And, you know, the thing about entrepreneurship, it's like there is no certainty in entrepreneurship. The only thing that's certain about entrepreneurship is uncertainty.
Yeah.
And being able to accept the fact that fear is just part and parcel of this business.
Absolutely. And I think when it comes to that, if you sort of try and relate even more, is that if you aren't doing something that has that massive risk of failure, then you probably shouldn't be doing it all. Then you're not trying hard enough. Then you're just sitting in your comfort zone. Then it's not actually worth that undertaking if it's something that is going to be something that you know is going to work for sure. And what really are you going to be pushing out of yourself and putting out of yourself to create anything great, to break boundaries with, or to take yourself to a next level if you are just going to do the same thing and don't have the actual really terrifying fear of failure?
Yeah, it's just you have to deal with it, you know. But that's the thing, people don't recognize that the fear is what stops them from making decisions. And decisions are your ultimate powers. Like, when you really decide to leave an abusive relationship, you're going to leave that thing, right? But otherwise, the fear of not leaving that abusive relationship, what if I'm going to find someone else after I leave this man or woman, you know? What if? And, you know, people worry about all this stuff, but 99% of the things that I've worried about in my life never happen. Yeah. And so you become trapped by fear.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, you get 2 types of entrepreneurs: those who let the fear of failure define them, and then those that let the fear of failure push them forward.
Yeah.
And you have to decide from day one what that's going to be, because if you're on the fence, you're done.
Let's talk imperfections. You talked about harnessing failures, and a big part of the book is also harnessing your imperfections to make them work in your advantage and not be discouraged by them, but instead use them to, you know, take yourself a whole lot further.
So I had an interesting conversation about imperfection with Brian Altrich, the CEO of Rocker Mamas. How many of you like Rocker Mamas here? Everyone, especially the youngsters. But basically, Brian built a massive business on imperfection. Weird, eh? If you look at the actual hamburger patty of a Rocker Mama's hamburger versus what you get from a McDonald's or Burger King, it's perfect, right? It's the perfect hamburger. It's flat. There's no imperfections. The cheese is perfectly cut, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And Brian's whole thing was, well, I'm going to be different. And so he built the Smash Burger, which essentially is a mess. So if you have 6 hamburgers on a plate, every single one of those hamburgers looks different. And he was recounting to me the story about these massive carpets that the Persians used to make. And it takes 12 men a year to make these carpets, right? Some crazy number like that. And what they do is they deliberately misstitch the carpet. Why would they do that? Because for them, God is perfect and nothing should be as perfect as God. But when you look at the value of these Persian rugs and what they go for, and they actually did these tests. It's a funny thing. They actually put all these rugs up and they put people through and they said, hey, just tell us which one of these rugs looks imperfect to you. And 95% of the subjects could identify the imperfect carpets. We are drawn to imperfection. You know, we are all flawed. And it's like when you acknowledge the fact that you are flawed and when you can talk about your kind of flawedness to people in an open and honest fashion, they go, geez, you know what? I'm like Matt Brown. I'm like, you know, Maps Maponyane. I'm like Brendan. I'm like whoever it is, because people resonate with people who remind them most of themselves. It's a weird thing. But yet we try and strive for this idea of perfection, but nothing's perfect. Who's perfect in this room? Anyone? Q? No? Anyone? You're kind of there, right? But you're not quite. And it's recognizing that truth. You know, and again, that comes back to your story, recognizing that you are flawed, you're not perfect, so why should you try and achieve or live up to the expectations of others?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's it's a nonsensical game.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think if you don't mind me bringing anything personal sort of regarding that, I think a lot of, even in terms of creating an image within film, media, entertainment for myself, has been on imperfection. In this case, being like virtually blind, I wear glasses doing everything. And when I started out, I couldn't get any type of gig, be it for TV presenting or modeling or acting, because I was the guy who was always wearing glasses, and I just looked like, boring, nerdy guy next door. It wasn't cool enough, sexy enough. And then I just decided that I was going to make it my thing, no matter what. And I pushed that as much as possible. And I remember an agency took a chance on me, and I got one job, then two jobs and three jobs, and started building this sort of repertoire that other agencies started, trying to find guys with glasses, and that became a thing. And that became a trademark for me, where I just decided to stick to me being who I am as Mups, and the fact that I wear glasses, I know I can barely see, and I'm going to make that my sort of, trademark, call it cool factor with everything. And I think it's important to harness those kinds of things as much as possible to work on your failure. From the first words I ever uttered till the age of about 12 years old, I had a very severe stutter. And I was made fun of nonstop in primary school and, the end of primary school. And it's something where it was really tough to, fit in with friends. You've got adults as well as your peers always trying to complete your sentences. It's a frustrating thing. You have low self-esteem. You can't really get anything out there. And for me, my one mission was always to, as soon as I can form a sentence together without having to have all these speed bumps as I'm trying to get it out. As soon as I can do that more confidently and more often, I'm going to make that my thing. And when I overcame my stutter, I decided that I was going to try and harness his oratory skill as much as possible, and that would be what would monetize my life. And now everything I do revolves around speaking. So I think one of those lessons in that book was so important to, instead of shying on that, see how you can embrace that and harness it and make it your thing that can make you stand out, from the crowd and really make you, I think bring the best potential out of yourself.
Yeah, so there's a lot of talk about authenticity. So the kind of context there is that, we're living in this kind of really, deliberately using this word, fucked up time where everything's trying to strive for perfection. Instagram filters, imagine if we all lived our Facebook feeds, how amazing our lives would be, and it's not real, in the youth today, it's like there's this peer pressure to be perfect. What filter? And I mean, like, you even see the kids trying to take selfies and stuff. It's just like, it's a weird psychodrama thing that they're having play out in front of themselves with other people watching, but they're not totally aware. And so, it's about finding your authentic self, and living yourself for a living. That is the only job we should actually give a fuck about.
Yeah.
All
right. Entrepreneurship. Why entrepreneurship? Because you state at the start of the book that, there is no formula. There is no, strict guide. This is just merely a few things that you've managed to draw from people's journeys, and hopefully can help you, whoever's reading it. But why is entrepreneurship so important to you to be able to emphasize as much as possible? Because your one mission, I feel, from my interactions with you, is to create as many entrepreneurs within people as possible.
Yeah, it's like entrepreneurship, So if you're working in a corporate job, that's fine. If you want to be an entrepreneur, that's fine. If you want to work for an NGO and become a social entrepreneur, that's fine. If you want to be an author, that's also fine. But pick a struggle. Pick something, because if you decide to be an entrepreneur, that's going to come with a world of pain. If you're going to work in the corporate space, that's going to come with a world of pain. If you're going to decide to write a book like this, good luck. It's going to come with a world of pain, but pick a struggle that you're going to fall in love with. Because, again, it's to your point around experiences, it's like you have to fall in love with the problem over and over and over again. And that's where happiness comes from. It's about solving things that you give a shit about, and figuring that out for yourself. And that's the secret.
And last but not least, before we go to the floor, Matt Brown is Africa's answer to Tim Ferriss. How does that make you feel?
Yeah. Humbled. That's rich, though.
Coming from you.
Yeah, exactly. Touché.
Touché. You either got that or you didn't. All right. Now, to the audience, any questions for Matt about his book? Any questions regarding entrepreneurship? Anything at all? It usually takes one person just to get it going. Ah, there's one at the back. Oh, there we go, right here.
I just want to say, Matt, thank you. I've walked this journey literally in terms of in the park and having chatted to you about what it was you were up to. You were really an inspiration for me. And the circle got bigger, and I actually launched my schools this week.
Oh, so, wow. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. So it is, and so challenge accepted. Book on its way.
Yes.
I have a question. So, Matt, on your podcasts, the last question you always ask everyone, and you've sort of touched on it when you spoke about your why, but you always ask them, why do you do what you do? What gets you out of bed in the morning? And now I want to know why you do what you do and what gets you out of bed in the morning.
This sucks.
It was either that or who is Matt Brown?
No. Let's not do that. No, the why is a good one. As you say, I did kind of touch on it, but you know, I think for me, the one thing I'd really want to land with everyone, if you could just remember one thing from the last 45 minutes, is like, answer this question: who are you becoming? And the second thing I'd want you to consider is, who are you helping? You know, because it's the only thing that really, like, in my experience, and you know, just talking to very successful, happy people, is that contribution really matters. You know, it's not about the numbers. That's, you know, when you get there, you're going to buy a lot of dumb shit. I've done that, and then you realize, actually, well, what is it about then? And it's actually about contribution and doing things that help you become better than you were the day before. So it is really about becoming, because every day we're learning and we're changing and we're growing, and it's just about being open to what those experiences give you.
There's a question at the back there from the gentleman with the beard, and then there's the one with the gentleman at the back with a lot less hair.
So, this is very loud. So say you want to be an entrepreneur, what advice would you give to someone who's trying to find their passion? Say you have a drive to do something, but you don't know what that is yet.
Just start. Yeah. You know, it's like you're never going to have all the information, so just start with what you have. You know, if you think, you know, I can tell you the other thing. Every business that's ever started has never survived first contact with the customer, ever. No business plan is a great exercise in theoretical thinking, but it doesn't actually exist in the real world. It's pretty worthless, right? And so you have to figure out what that is. What's the value exchange between yourself as the founder and the market and the customer and the problem ultimately that you care about, right? So pick a problem that the world has and then go out there and solve it. So Elon Musk, you know, he cares about making human beings a multi-planetary species. You know what I'm saying? Richard Branson with the Branson Foundation is all about encouraging the growth of entrepreneurship. So pick a problem that the world has and that you think you might care enough about to solve, and then go and try. But try. Do something. Execute, because actions speak far louder than words. And when you fail, incorporate that into what you're trying to solve and iterate and start again and move and move and move and move. But never quit. Never give up, because when you quit, you automatically fail.
So some inhuman perseverance.
Basically, yeah.
Thanks, Matt.
I was going to elaborate on that, but I don't think we have time. It's fine. Strict orders.
Hi, Matt.
Hey, man.
Tell me, why do you value putting the world first? Yeah, that's my question.
Why do I put the world first?
Yes.
Hey? Why do you value putting the world first?
Why do I value putting the world first? Because that's where value is created. It doesn't, you know what I'm saying? It's like it comes from you, but the exchange happens outside of you. Yeah. And it's about understanding that people will only pay you for the value that you create in the world. If you want to be a billionaire, right, don't just think, you know, like the secret, get a blank check, write $1 billion, stick it on your roof. Good luck. right? That's option one. Option two is go and solve a problem for a billion people. Then you'll be a billionaire. It's very easy. Yeah.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the great ways of looking at it. But even furthermore, in terms of you know, finding that purpose in what you want to do, just kind of remembering, I always remember the words by Winston Churchill, which is, we make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give.
You only get to keep what you give away.
I would accept the clap, but I'm not Winston Churchill, but thanks.
Winston.
We have a question here and there, I think. I'll come to you now.
So you speak a lot about failure. So I just want to try and understand, how did you overcome that, and how would a normal individual overcome failure in their lives? Because it's pretty hard to deal with it. You kind of just become despondent towards life, towards everything you're trying to achieve. So how did you overcome it?
Just accepting that that's the truth. You know, you're not going to build anything of value unless you fail. It's like what irks me quite a lot about, you know, media, startup business-focused media, is that on the front cover of magazines, it's like, you know, from 0 to 50 million in 3 years, no failure. Zero, none. You just became rich. You know, it wouldn't be rad, right? Just, and then you read and, oh, okay, actually, there was a bit of failure in there. You know what I'm saying? So it's an inevitable part of becoming someone better than you were the day before. But you have to embrace the fact that you're going to fail. It's a simple thing. But it takes guts, right, and courage and character.
Sure. Thanks. What I wanted to ask is maybe sort of the opposite of that question. And that's to do with actually fulfilling your purpose. If you feel, maybe it's a two-part question, but what happens when you actually reach your purpose? How do you define a new purpose? And secondly, how do you state a purpose that's not finite, that has this end goal in mind so that you actually achieve it?
This one's for you. Don't throw me under the bus, dude. I know it's my, come on, man, you know. Well, I think, listen, I think from my experience, you know, one, you don't find it, you have to create it. And so when you're there and you've now found it after you've created it, why would you change it? Do you know what I mean? So I guess there's a question behind the question for me, and I get this a lot, which is, when should I quit my business? And there's a framework that I use, which is about vision, and then is your business making money? So, and I write about it in the book, but, you know, are you still in love with the vision? And is the business making money? If you're not in love with the vision and the business is making money, well, then you should probably question why you're in that business. If you're not in love with the vision and the business is not making money, then you should absolutely consider throwing in the towel, right? But it's about understanding that there's a vision for yourself, there's a vision for the world that you have, and are you in love with that vision every single day that you get up out of bed in the morning? And are you prepared to take the shit and shovel all the shit that it's going to take to get that vision manifested in your life?
Does that answer your question?
Matt, can I tell you a story?
Please.
First of all, I'm loving the book. I haven't got to the end of it yet, but I've loved every bit. And if you haven't bought the book, I think you should go buy multiple copies now.
I can tell you what happens at the end of it.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm not paid for that. but the story I want to tell you relates to a story that you told. At some point in time, my parents got bored and decided to do a Persian carpet course. And I don't know, you know, down the road is Victor Leachy, who has his annual closing down sale. So now, armed with a course, my parents went to Victor Leachy to go do purchasing at his annual closing down sale, and they found a carpet they absolutely loved, with a terrible black stain in it. And they called over Victor Leachy and said, we love this carpet, we really want to buy it, but it's got a terrible black stain. And he said, let me tell you a story, the story that you told, that in Iran, in fact, in Persia, only God creates perfection, and man does not, and therefore they deliberately weave a mistake into the carpet, so you know it's the work of man rather than God. And my parents ummed and awed over this carpet for a while, where one of the other salespeople came over and said, can I help you? And they said, well, we love this carpet, but it's got a terrible black mark in it. And the guy went and got a bucket of water and soap, and he scrubbed it, and suddenly the imperfection disappeared. And this And the part that I want to do, the lesson that I draw from that story, is that all of us in business sometimes go home, stick on the shower for a very long time, and we walk out and our imperfections go away and we start the next day absolutely clean and fresh and new. And that's one of the lessons that I've drawn from your book, that no matter how many times you get knocked down, if you have it in you, you have that shower, you do the little scrub, and your perfections disappear.
Preach. Thank you, Howard. Round of applause.
Awesome. Thank you, Howard. A certified fan there. That's awesome. Howard, you sure you won't pay to say that? Because then you're going to have to say #ad, #sponsored. It's a new ARB rulings. I don't know if you know that. Anyone else with a question? There you go.
Thanks for the questions.
Hi, Matt.
Hey.
Oh, this is loud. Can I get up?
Yeah, go for it.
I've got two questions to ask you, right? So, you being where you are right now, what is more important to you? Making money off of what you're doing or having the ability to create?
I would say having the ability. In fact, none of those. Yeah. You agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. I, you know what? I don't care about my business. I really don't. I care about the people. That work to help me build my dreams. You know, and that comes first and foremost, you know, and when you understand that a business is just a group of people working together to achieve something, and that culture beats any strategy, any product, it's like I don't really view any other business as our competition because they can't compete with our culture. You know, and, you know, we do think we're building a personal development culture where we're looking at individuals in the business and kind of creating legitimately personal development related interventions to help them become better. And when multiple, when you do that across 10, we're 20 people now, like in January, there was two of us, you know, yeah, it's a funny story. I should tell you about that one. But it involved a broom covered in an Indian. He's over there. But it's about people, you know, and we wouldn't be scaling up. We wouldn't have won Africa's best tech startup if it wasn't for the culture.
Okay, my next question is, okay, I'm into podcasting as well, and I've figured out that I care about the small stuff. Hence, I focus so much into detail in terms of everything that I love. So with you being where you are right now, what still keeps you going? Because it seems like you have it all together. What still keeps you going?
I absolutely don't have it all together. I have those showers that Howard talks about, and I cry to myself about what a failure I was today and why I did that thing, I shouldn't have done that thing. But it's curiosity. You know, the more I think about the answer to that, it's literally curiosity. Like I only know one way, and that's to do it big. You know, and to literally keep pushing and see where the universe pushes back. Then I stop and I'm like, okay, maybe I went too far there, but I'm going to go left and then I'm going to keep pushing again and keep pushing again. It's about this curiosity and, as I said earlier, this hunger for what's out there. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you don't try, if you're not curious about what's in it for you and what, you know, what life has in front of you, you know what I mean? Like,
so you're basically a sponge.
Basically, yeah. Yeah.
Thanks, eh?
Thank you very much.
Matt, first of all, congratulations. Very proud. I've had the privilege of working with you, and I want to understand when you had those moments where life got a bit tough in the beginning, when those businesses initially had a little bit of a fall off, and you dug deep and you had the tenacity to get up and do it again. What was your motivator?
Being more scared about not doing something than being scared of actually failing again. That's pretty much it. Yeah. You know, imagine, again, it's like that regret thing. You know what I mean? If I don't do this thing, then what if I did? And I'd hate to live that life. That's instant. Yeah.
And here. Hi, so I've got two kind of questions about a similar topic, authenticity, really. So my one question is, to be your authentic self and to share your story, how do you kind of know that you're telling your story in a way that's not coming across like you're either sounding as though you know everything or as if you're feeling sorry for yourself.
It's okay to feel sorry for yourself. So I would say that the only way to truly know that you're living your authentic self is when you continually die to the past and live today. Because that's all you got. You know, when I can't tell you, anxiety only happens when you're projecting about the future. You get depressed when you think about the past. You only have today, you know. But in terms of expressing your authenticity, that's a choice. You know, and so it comes down to reputation. You know, a lot of people said to me, like, I had this huge fear of, like, what if people will judge the book? You know, this imposter syndrome thing. And, like, I put out so much content. And like, there's always that undercurrent, like, well, what will people think about the thing that I said? And I'm a prisoner to my words forever. You understand? And then it's about acknowledging the fact that, you know, what is reputation? And where should your reputation with yourself live? Should it live with you or should it live with other people? And, you know, and so it should only live with you. And so you shouldn't give a shit about what other people think about you, how you say, how you express yourself, how you dress, the people you date, the things you say, whether you swear, whether you don't. Who gives a shit? Yeah. That's you, right?
Yeah, cool. I actually answered all the questions. It's fine.
Two for one.
One more question somewhere there. Oh, there we go.
From the older generation, looking at the millennials, I actually want to get younger, but anyway, that's too late. But
it's never too late.
This is what I'm coming to. What do you think of a discussion with Bill Gates where it goes something like this? As a head of Microsoft, you ripped off the world putting software into every person's desk and telephone. And you could have actually stimulated a different market had you been more modest in your marketing aggression. Now you've created this enormous wealth called the Bill Gates Foundation, and you're giving it to selective parts of community. Is that the right formula, or is it something else?
I mean, honestly, for me, I would generally say, who are we to say, right? I mean, he's managed to garner all that wealth and be able to use at least 10% of it a year, putting it back into society. What the exact right way is, you know, is preference to each person. But I think if he's actually making some sort of an impact with it and is trying to give back and is trying to find the value within his life for all the wealth that he's managed to make, you can't really say whether it's the right way or not.
The only thing I'd say there is that he gave most of it away.
Yeah.
You know, so he was like, cool, I'm minted.
Yeah.
Here, I'm going to give away 95% of it away. Warren Buffett did the same thing. He still lives in the dodgy house that he's been living in for like 40 years with his wife.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's like it's when, but the thing is, you have to make the money to learn that it's not about the money.
Exactly.
You know, and also you have to say, you have to ask bigger questions, which is, why am I in this position? Why did I get so lucky? And it's a burden. You know, it's a struggle, by the way, that he has to live with. What am I supposed to do with, you know, $50 billion? What must I do with that, actually? It's a big question.
The Gates live in a far less, sort of humble home. But when they're spending an average of, in the Gates Foundation, I get to do a lot of work with them. They spend an average of $5.8 billion a year just on their charitable causes, which are actually making massive, massive differences around the world. So, yeah. But I completely understand that question, too.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. Absolutely. If you don't mind indulging me for a little bit, there's one thing that I remember reading years ago that I think sums this book up beautifully and sort of entrepreneurship as a whole. And it's something that was a answer to a question on Quora, which is, you know, a place where people ask a lot of burning questions and also not so burning questions. And it was asked at Justine Musk, Elon Musk's ex-wife. And the question was, will I become a billionaire if I'm determined to be one and put in the necessary work required? Justine Musk then answered, will you become a billionaire if you're simply determined to be one and put in the necessary work required? No, probably not. One of the many qualities that separate self-made billionaires from the rest of us is their ability to ask the right questions. this is not the right question, which is not to say it's a bad question. Which is not to say it's a bad question. It just won't get that deep. Sorry, it just won't get to that deep part of your mind working to help you. Mulling things over when you think you're thinking about something else, sending up flares of insight. You're determined. So what? You haven't been racing naked through shark-infested waters yet. Will you be just as determined when you wash up on some deserted island, disoriented and bloody and ragged and beaten and staring into the horizon with no sign of rescue? We live in a culture that celebrates determination and hard work, but understand these are the qualities that keep you in the game after most of everybody has left, must be a typo, or until somebody bigger and stronger picks you up and hurls you back out to sea. Determination and hard work are necessary, yes, but they are the minimum requirements, as in the absolute bare minimum. A lot of people work extremely hard and through no fault of their own, bad luck, the wrong environment, unfortunate circumstances, struggle to survive. How can you leverage your time and your work? Well, shift your focus away from what you want, $1 billion, and get deeply intensely curious about what the world wants and needs. Ask yourself what you have the potential to offer that is so unique and compelling and helpful that no computer could replace you. No one could outsource you, and no one could steal your product and make it better and then club you into oblivion, not literally. Then develop that potential. Choose one thing and become a master of it. Choose a second thing and become a master of that too. When you become a master of two worlds, say engineering and business, you can bring them together in a way that will A, introduce hot ideas to each other so they can have idea sex and make idea babies that no one has seen before. B, create a competitive advantage because you can move between worlds, speak both languages, connect the tribes, mash the elements to spark fresh creative insights until you wake up with the epiphany that changes your life. The world doesn't throw $1 billion at a person because the person wants it so bad or works so hard that they feel they deserve it. The world does not care what you want or deserve. The world gives you money in exchange for something it perceives to be of equal or greater value, something that transforms an aspect of culture, reworks a familiar story, or introduces a new one, alters the way people think about the category, and make use of it in a daily life. There is no roadmap, no blueprint for this, and a lot of people will give you a lot of advice, and most of it will be bad, and a lot of it will be good and sound, but you'll have to figure it out and how it doesn't apply to you because you're coming from an unexpected angle and you'll be doing it alone, something that you speak about often, doing it alone. Until you develop... Oh, phone just let me down there. I beg your pardon there. Until you develop...
The one thing about technology is that it will always let you down.
This is true as well. There we go. And most of it will be bad and a lot of it will be good and sound, but you'll have to figure it out and how it doesn't simply apply to you because you're coming from an unexpected angle. And you'll be doing it alone until you develop the charisma and credibility to attract the talents you need to come with you. Have courage. You will need it. And good luck. You'll need that too.
Thank you.
So a lot of what the book speaks about is towards that. And I just want to wrap this up by saying thank you to each and every one of you for coming out, firstly. But secondly, he mentioned legacy a few times, and there's something so beautiful that I think sums this up beautifully around legacy. And there's a great quote around legacy, which is the fact that if you want to leave a lasting legacy, then do something worth writing about, or write something that's worth reading. And I think he's definitely written something that's worth reading in this book. Thank you very much, Angel. Thank you very much, Matt. Congratulations.
Thanks, dude.
Next time I'll see you in white.
Okay, fine, deal. just to echo that, just thanks to each and every one of you for giving us your time. It's your most valuable commodity. And thank you. And yeah, if you want to buy the book, great. Otherwise, it's all good.
And of course, there's a book signing for everyone that wants to stay for the book signing, which is each and every one of you. Thank you. Matt has got... I think it's going to be just around the corner.
Yeah.
He signs really quickly. And I think you'll really enjoy the fact that it's all personalized. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Maps. Thanks, Maps. Maps Maponyane, everybody.